Welcome to episode 6 of Terrain Rendering. Please fasten your seatbelts, ladies and gentlemen, because today we are cranking up the complexity of our terrain system with the introduction of Geomipmapping, which is an algorithm that enables continuous level of detail. This basically means that pieces of land which are closer to the camera are going to be rendered in higher resolution. As the distance from the camera increases, the terrain will be rendered in lower resolution. You can think about it as the geometry equivalent of texture meat mapping, where a high resolution image is used close to the camera and lower resolution images are used at greater distances. The net result is that we can reduce the number of triangles which are sent to the GPU for processing, while increasing the resolution where it matters the most, which is close to the camera. The way this will work is that instead of rendering a simple grid, which is composed of triangles of the same size, we will render a set of patches, where a patch is simply a square divided into several triangles. In the highest level of detail, the patch is identical to the current grid in the sense that every quad of 4 vertices defines 2 triangles. However, as the level of detail decreases, we start skipping vertices. The effect is that we move from a large set of small triangles to a smaller set of larger triangles. Geomipmapping was invented by Willem de Boer in the year 2000. I'm going to show a variation of the algorithm based on the book Focus on 3D Terrain Programming by Trent Polak. In the future, I may revisit the original implementation due to a potential performance improvement. Let's see how to get Geomipmapping up and running. Right now, our vertex setup is pretty rigid. We have a single index buffer, which organizes a single vertex buffer into triangles. The two buffers are sent together in a single draw call to the GPU for rendering. This setup doesn't provide the required flexibility for a dynamic triangle resolution, so obviously we will need to change it. The solution is to break the grid into a set of patches. Instead of a single draw call, we will have multiple draw calls, one for each patch. In addition, the indices will be reorganized in a way which will allow us to render the same patch of vertices in different ways: the maximum number of triangles close to the camera and less triangles in the distance. The bonus that this new setup provides is that it will be very simple for us to drop patches which are outside of the view frustum and avoid spending any GPU cycles on them. The frustum culling optimization will be covered in a future video in this series, so please make sure to subscribe if you haven't already. Now let's turn our attention to the concept of level of detail, or LOD. The most detailed LOD is 0. In this level, the maximum number of non-overlapping triangles using a given set of vertices is rendered. The smallest patch in this system is a 3x3 square of vertices, which looks like a triangle fan. While in theory you can bring the number of triangles here down to 2, for reasons which will become apparent later, we prefer to use this structure as the smallest patch. Notice that 3 vertices is actually 2 to the power of 1, plus an extra vertex. This is important for later. Let's try a patch of 4x4 vertices. As you can see, we can no longer support the triangle fan structure without breaking it into smaller pieces. Therefore, I've made a design decision to only support cases where the patch is composed of only complete triangle fans. This means that the size of the patch in vertices must be an odd number. The next patch is a 5x5, and as you can see, this works very nicely. We now have a 2x2 grid of triangle fans. By the way, 5 equals to 2 to the power of 2 plus an extra vertex. Are you seeing a pattern here? So let's try 7. It seems to work okay. There are 9 complete triangle fans here. The problem is that we are building a continuous LOD system here, which means that there will be one patch of a higher LOD right next to a patch of a lower LOD. If we are not careful, there might be cracks in the terrain, and these are basically showstoppers in terms of quality. So we have to crack-proof our terrain. A crack is a result of two patches sharing an edge, where there are 2 triangles on one side of the shared edge and one triangle on the other side. Whenever the middle vertex is not the average height of the two side vertices, and this is rarely the case, there will be a crack because on one side we have the true height, and on the other side we have an interpolated height. The solution in general is to make sure that we always have the same number of triangles on the two sides of an edge, and the vertices are always synchronized. In the case of the 7x7 patch, we can kind of force this to happen, but as you can see, the structure of the patch is no longer homogeneous, and this creates a ton of corner cases that I prefer avoiding. I believe that by placing a few limitations on the size of the terrain and the patch, I was able to simplify the implementation, which enabled me to bring it up and running very quickly. These limitations do not make the implementation less practical. So in order for the LOD system to work correctly, the size of the patch must be a power of 2 plus 1 vertex. In the case of a 3x3 patch, there is a single LOD. We can't go below this. In the case of a 5x5 patch, we have two levels of detail. Let's see what happens when we place those two LODs next to each other. As you can see, there's a danger of a crack on those two vertices. By the way, just to clarify, this channel doesn't support the use of drugs of any kind, except, you know, maybe World of Warcraft. So the solution is to drop the problematic vertices on the higher LOD patch and reduce the number of triangles on that edge from 4 down to 2. This means that we will need to support some kind of a variation on the structure of the patch, but as you shall see, it's pretty consistent and not very difficult to implement. This brings us to the next limitation, which is that we can only go down one LOD at a time. This means that a patch of LOD 0 can be right next to a patch of LOD 1, but not, for example, 3. Therefore, a patch must be flexible enough to support going down a single LOD on each of its four sides and nothing more. The higher LOD will be ready to match itself to the lower LOD and not vice versa. The terrain itself is of course composed of a set of patches. Up until this point, we allow the terrain to be of any size. However, various combinations of terrain and patch sizes may lead to incomplete patches on the edge of the terrain. Again, a corner case that I prefer to avoid. So the final limitation is to force the terrain to contain only complete patches. All these limitations can sometimes be a bit tricky to get right, so I've included some code that calculates the closest valid sizes to the user's input as a recommendation. If anything fails, check the console window and use the recommended size. Due to the complexity of the algorithm, I decided to split this topic into two videos. This video provides an overview and brings up the basic infrastructure of the system. The next video will focus on continuous LOD, which means how to render patches of different LODs side by side. So let's take a few minutes to discuss what we need to do to actually implement this. The good news is that 99% of the changes will focus on the TriangleList class, which is responsible for rendering the vertex grid. Other than providing the patch size during the initialization of the system, there are almost no changes anywhere else. I want to keep the old version of the TriangleList class available for future use, so I've created a new class called GeomipGrid for Geomipmapping. As you can see, the only actual change here is that the user provides the patch size as a parameter, in addition to the terrain size, and we have a corresponding private attribute to save it. Most of the changes are in the implementation of the class. The function createGeomipGrid checks that the requested terrain size contains complete patches. If it doesn't, it calculates a recommended size. This is not very complex, so you can figure it out yourself offline. Now here's the interesting part. In order to render in patches, we have to realize that we don't really need three indices for every triangle in the grid. We can actually prepare a small subset of indices for a square of vertices, and then use gldrawElements_baseVertex instead of gldrawElements. This function takes an additional parameter called baseVertex and adds it to every index in the draw call. Here's a very simple example. Let's say we have a grid of 3x3 vertices. We have a total of 8 triangles and 24 indices. Notice that we are still on the old triangle layout, but it will work the same for the patches. Instead of 24 indices, we can use only 6, 0, 3, 4, and 0, 4, 1. If we call GLDrawElements base vertex and set base vertex to be 3, then 0, 3, 4 becomes 3, 6, 7, and 0, 4, 1 becomes 3, 7, 4. This will render the top left quadrant of the grid. We can do the same for the other quadrants. So we only need enough indices to accommodate a single patch. The rest will be handled by the base vertex. We can see the change in the size of the index vector. The number of quads is calculated based on the size of the patch, rather than the size of the terrain. There is a similar change in the function that initializes the index vector. We run over the size of the patch instead of the size of the terrain. The function that calculates the normal vectors is a bit more complex. We still need to go over all the vertices, so we traverse the terrain size in patch size steps, calculate the base vertex for each patch, and then traverse the patch indices using the base vertex to get to the correct vertex. The final change is in the render function. Instead of a single call to GLDrawElements, we have multiple calls to GLDrawElements base vertex. We traverse the terrain size again in patch size steps, calculate the base vertex, and the number of triangles is based on the patch size and not the terrain size. If everything was done correctly, we can render the terrain, and it should look exactly the same as the original implementation. The next step is to change the layout of the triangles to a triangle fan. While OpenGL supports a triangle fan topology, I decided to stick to the regular triangle list because triangle fan is not supported in DirectX, starting from D3D10. I plan to support DirectX in the future, so it's better to avoid any possible incompatibility. In order to switch to the new layout, we have to make changes to the function that initializes the indices. This function creates a triangle fan from each 3x3 grid, so it has to traverse both axes, two vertices at a time. First, we calculate the index of the center vertex, because it will be part of all the triangles. Then we calculate the index of the bottom left vertex, and the next one on the z-axis. We call these variables temp1 and temp2, because we are going around the center, and on each step, the forward vertex will be copied to the one behind it, and then updated by the next vertex. The helper function addTriangle takes the current location in the index buffer, the index vector, and the three indices of the current triangle. It copies the indices into the vector and returns the location for the next triangle. This makes it very easy to add triangles without thinking exactly where their indices need to go. The next index is the top left, then the top center, and then the top right. From there, we start going down along the right edge. On each step, we add a triangle using the center vertex and the two running indices. In total, we add 8 triangles. After finishing this function, the entire patch is tessellated with 3x3 triangle fans. This is basically the highest LOD for each patch size. You can click on W to switch to wireframe and enjoy the new look of the vertex grid. In the next video, we will see how to make different LODs work together side by side and select the proper LOD according to the distance from the camera. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next episode of Terrain Rendering.